Building your own gaming computer can be lots of fun, but sometimes choosing the parts you're going to build with can be the most challenging part. That is what this series is all about. Welcome to Build Fix, episode number 5 for July. I have three systems I'm going to talk about today. We have a high-end build, we have a 5800X 3D user who is wondering whether to upgrade their platform or their GPU, and we even have an Intel build.
Excellent!
A few notes before we dive in. This series is proudly sponsored by PCPartPicker, and I will be using their website to organize the builds and to choose parts. A big thank you to them for their support of this series. Also, if you would like to submit your build for the next episode, then definitely get subscribed to my YouTube channel because I do monthly posts like this on the community tab asking people to submit their parts lists. They can use PCPartPicker or they can just give me a list. And there's also an associated poll, in case you're wondering. Pizza was the runaway victor in this round. Poor sandwich down there with only 7%. Now, because it's July 2024 and there's some new launches coming down the pipeline this year, you should be keeping those in mind if you're considering building a new PC. We have new AM5 CPUs coming out really soon from AMD. Those will slot into their current platform AM5 motherboards, and we're expecting those to launch in about 2 weeks at the end of July. So if you're about to build a new computer, it might be worth your while to wait for those launches to happen, especially if you're about to buy into AM5. We're also expecting Intel to launch an entirely new platform, LGA 1851 motherboards. That's expected later in the year. We don't have a solid launch date for that. It's rumored to be anywhere from September to December. So a bit of a longer wait if you're holding out for the next gen Intel stuff. And then recent news has revealed that Intel's having some issues with their current CPUs as well. 13th and 14th generation Raptor Lake and Raptor Lake refresh CPUs, especially the highest end models 13900K and 14900K, have some questions around their long-term viability and failure rates. This is one of the top comments on the community post, and it's definitely something to consider right now if you're about to buy in. And if you'd like a synopsis of the situation, which was recently escalated to a higher level by Wendell of Level 1 Techs, check out the last episode of Tech News. With all that said, the first build I'm going to look at today was submitted by JerrenB, who's looking for a $1,000 budget build for his little cousin to stream Warzone and GTA mods. And JerrenB is specifically asking for a stable Intel processor based on their past experience having issues with AMD but not so much with Intel. And my gut response to this would be to point out some of the recent woes that Intel users have been having, specifically with 13th and 14th gen CPUs. Also the fact that their current platform, LGA 1700, is effectively end of life. There are no new CPUs that are gonna be launching for it. And at the same time, AMD's current AM5 platform hasn't been having any of the stability problems that Intel has been having, and it has a longer lifespan ahead of it. AMD has already promised support for that platform through 2027 and beyond. If you've taken all that into consideration and you're still like, nope, I'm gonna go with Intel, I've had a good experience in the past, I'm not gonna tell you don't do that, but here is the build that I've put together if you're looking for something less than $1,000. For this purpose, I've gone with an Intel 12th generation CPU, the Alder Lake, first generation that launched on LGA 1700. This has not been having the potential degradation issues that some of the other CPUs have been having. And by the way, for anyone who's currently using 13th or 14th gen, bear in mind that a lot of the problems have cropped up on the server side of things where the CPUs are being running 24/7 in a different use case type scenario than home use. That said, we're still waiting for more data to come out. We're still waiting for Intel to do some sort of a public addressing of these problems. For now, the 12th gen is actually very competitively priced. And again, a lot of this has to do with Prime Day deals that are going on right now, but with a $58 off instant promo code, this brings the CPU down to about $173, and there's comparable pricing over at B&H. And we can see if we look at the price history here, this is among the lowest price that we've ever seen, or that PC Part Picker has ever seen for this part. It's a 12 core, 20 thread processor. It's the KF. The K means it's unlocked for overclocking. The F means it doesn't include integrated graphics. If you need an iGPU to go along with game streaming or something like that, consider paying $10 to $15 more for the 12700K non-F. And because Intel's K-SKU processors don't come with a cooler, I have dropped on a very competitively priced ID cooling SE224. And I know you guys are like, why not thermal rate? Well, there's other like competitively priced, inexpensive air coolers out there. And for $24, this is gonna get the job done and save you 10 bucks or so versus the other option. Another advantage of going with Intel's slightly aging LGA 1700 platform is that some motherboards have dropped in price. You need a Z-series motherboard combined with a K-SKU CPU if you want to overclock overclock on Intel, so I've gone with the Z690M. The Phantom Gaming 4 by ASRock. Not a ton of bells and whistles here, but you got your basic connectivity. You don't have a USB 3.2 Gen 2 front panel header here, but you do have a couple M.2 drives. Decent power delivery for overclocking. You even got an 8-pin plus 4-pin power connector here, and do note that with less expensive power supplies, you might not have the plus 4-pin here as well. But as long as you're not doing serious overclocking, you can just plug in the 8-pin and you'll still be just fine. We also still have really good pricing on DDR4 memory here, and I went with a 32 gig kit. You could get away with a 2x8 gig kit for 16 gigs total, but if you're gonna be gaming and streaming at the same time, maybe dabbling with a little bit of video editing, having more memory is definitely a nice upgrade, and it's only $51 for this kit. Sticking with micro ATX means we have access to a bunch of very inexpensive but well kitted out micro ATX cases. Montec has come through with a lot of very good performing cases for low prices recently. The Air 100 ARGB has excellent reviews, comes with 4 fans pre-installed, so you're all set for airflow. They're even addressable RGB fans, so you can have your RGB taken care of, or you can just not plug in the RGB if you want to have a more stealthy look. I stuck to the budget on the power supply, going with the 650 watt 80 plus bronze unit from EVGA for less than $50. It's not modular or anything fancy like that, but it does keep the cost down. So with all those parts together and a 6700 XT graphics card for less than $300, the price here is not $1,000, it's actually closer to $800, so that gives us a little bit of breathing room to potentially upgrade one or two of these components. And the one I'm gonna focus on just for the moment is the graphics card, because there's lots of choices around this range. So first off, let me correct myself. Somehow I had a 6700 XT added, but I meant to do this 6750 XT for $270. That actually cuts another $10 off of the price, bringing the total cost for this build, as recommended, to about $777 before tax and shipping. So if you're looking at AMD Radeon options, where you're probably gonna get the best bang for your buck, especially in the sub $300 range, the 6750 XT, which will be on par with maybe a frame or two behind a RTX 4060 Ti in terms of rasterization, is a great way to go because you get 12 gigs of VRAM and you can find these for well under $300 right now. The next step up from there is a 7700 XT, which is coming in at about $360 for the cheapest one. That one's gonna be about 14 or 15% faster than the 6750 XT. And of course, from there you have the 7800 XT option, but that one jumps all the way up to $450, so probably a bit too rich. Meanwhile, on the NVIDIA side, we have the RTX 4060. Cheapest one of those is about $280. This is a slower card than the 6750 XT, so it's a bit harder of a sell at this price point. Between the 4060 and the 4060 Ti right now, I would definitely opt for the 4060 Ti. At about $345, it's still not the most competitively priced option, but a lot of people like to stick with NVIDIA, especially if you're into ray tracing, so that is somewhat understandable. And unfortunately, the step up from there is gonna be a 4070 or a 4070 Super, and those are both well over $500. All right, so there's my currently recommended Intel build for less than $1,000, coming in at less than $800 if you opt for a 6750 XT, or if you wanna opt for NVIDIA, swap in the 4060 Ti, currently on sale for $345, and that'll bring the price to about $850. And yes, for the time being, for right now, until we get more information directly from Intel or more investigation into the problem, I'm not gonna be recommending 13th and 14th gen CPUs. So let's switch over to another question from CJWright1960. This is an upgrade build. They already have a Samsung Odyssey G5. That's 1440 resolution, 165 hertz monitor, looking to spend about $1,000. They have about $1,000 to spend, and the current build is a 5800X 3D with an Octua cooler, a B550 motherboard, a 32 gig memory kit, an NVIDIA RTX 3070, a 2TB Samsung SSD, and a Corsair case and power supply. And the big question, which I think a lot of people who are on AM4, especially 5000 series, are considering right now, go AM5 motherboard and CPU, or keep rocking the AM4 and put the $1,000 into a new graphics card. All right, so I dropped all of CJ Wright's parts onto a build list. Note the compatibility warning here. That's because the 5800X3D is being paired with the MSI Mag B550 Tomahawk motherboard. And if you have an older version of that motherboard, it won't recognize that CPU unless you upgrade the BIOS. Fortunately, this motherboard has a BIOS flashback feature, so you can update the BIOS even without a CPU installed, so shouldn't be a problem. But overall here with the 5800X3D, the NHU12A, which is, oh my gosh, $130. That's probably standing out as like the most expensive component here that has less expensive options. But this build is already functional, so I'm not gonna tell you to buy different stuff than what you already have. And it is also a nice, well-rounded build, a 2x16 gig kit of DDR4 3200 CL16 memory from Corsair. I had to make a few assumptions with some of these parts because I didn't have some details, but we got a 2TB 970 Evo. That is an expensive 2TB SSD as well. The Founders Edition RTX 3070 isn't available for sale anymore, so we don't have a price for that, but the rest of the components are coming in at about $1,000 when you add the Corsair case and power supply too. For anyone who's building new right now, I don't think the AM4 platform and the 5000 series is compelling anymore because the 5800X 3D is selling for $350. The 7800X 3D on AM5, which is a faster processor, is down to like $375. So yes, there are additional platform costs combined with more expensive motherboards and slightly more expensive DDR5 memory, but I wouldn't recommend that anyone buys a 5800X 3D straight up right now doing a new build. If you're already on AM4, you wanna upgrade, something like that, it's okay. But you might find yourself in a situation kind of like this where you're looking to upgrade and you're gonna have to leave a lot of stuff behind if you want to move over to the next generation. So apart from dropping the CPU, we could keep the cooler, we're gonna need a new motherboard, we're gonna need a new memory, we can keep the SSD, we could keep the graphics card, but that's also something that is aging and looking like it could potentially be upgraded as well. And yes, your case and power supply are also still totally fine. So that's a rundown of the parts that you would want to swap out if you were going to be upgrading this system, and keep that in mind. But for now, because we have new CPUs launching in about 2 weeks, because we have some question marks as far as what Intel is going to be coming out with later in the year, and because we're also expecting Nvidia to drop the RTX 50 series sometime towards the end of this year, within the next, I don't know, 2 to 4 months, I think you should keep rocking your AM4 system. The 5800X 3D is still a totally good processor. And if you're really looking to drop some cash right now, upgrade your graphics card because the Nvidia launch is still a bit nebulous. We don't know exactly when that's gonna happen. I'm quickly jumping over to Tech Power Up just so we can get a look on their very convenient relative performance chart. You have an RTX 3070. So if we start with that as the 100% baseline here, your upgrade options are all of these cards scrolling down from there, which includes some RX 7000 series graphics cards, as well as some high-end Nvidia 30 series, as well as, of course, the Nvidia RTX 40 series, which includes the 4070 Ti, Ti Super. And since you're already using an Nvidia RTX 30 series graphics card, I'm going to assume that you're probably leaning towards Nvidia as well for your upgrade. But if you are considering AMD, the 7900 XT is like the best bang for the buck option in the higher end market. It's down to $650 or so, between $650 and $700 for a 7900 XT. And that also gives you 20 gigs of VRAM to work with. The XTX is a bit more pricey. It starts at just shy of $900. Meanwhile, on the Nvidia side, I'd say look at the 4070 Super, 4070 Ti Super, and 4080 Super. The 4070 Super is, I think, the best bang for the buck on the Nvidia side in the mid-range, and I know that's a bit of a stretch to say mid-range when you're talking about a $600 card, but at least they're available for less than $600 these days. That would also be less of a relative upgrade for your 3070 Founders Edition. 4070 Ti Super is a decent step up from there, but also a pretty significant jump in price. Those are going for about $760 to $770 at the cheapest. And then, of course, if you wanted to actually use up your $1,000 budget, the 4080 Super is available for less than $1,000. Still, this is towards the higher end. You're not gonna be getting the full amount of FPS out of this card with the 5800X 3D compared to something like the 7800X 3D. Honestly, it's a tough call to make, but I'm just gonna drop in the 4070 Ti Super here for $760. And again, I don't recommend anyone buy and build this build like as is, but it's $1,763 total with that added in. Our final build comes from Unfortunate Son 1365, who is completely new to PC building. They even had to buy a desk and a keyboard, a mouse and a mouse pad. They do already have a Samsung OLED Odyssey G8 monitor, which is a very nice monitor, regardless of which version he's talking about. The rest of the parts are listed here. I've put them on a PC part picker list. And the nice thing, look at the price here. We're looking at $2,000, not including the monitor. And again, that Samsung Odyssey G8 available in a couple different varieties. The 34-inch 3440 by 1440, which is 175 hertz refresh rate, is available for $800. I don't think this is the cheapest price it's ever been, but that is still a lot of really nice OLED monitor for not terribly expensive. There's also a 32-inch 4K that goes up to 240 hertz, and that one is $1,000. So yes, if you added that in, we would be right at your $3,000 price that you mentioned. And of course, don't forget the stuff I said at the beginning of this video about how AMD has new processors launching in a couple weeks, and that it's not necessarily the best time to dive in and buy right now. That said, look at the 7950X 3D, like top CPU if you want a combination of high core count and really good gaming performance. Up until May, June, the cheapest this processor had ever been was like about 500 $550. Now it is the lowest price it has ever been at about $460. And that is again, one of the potential advantages to take advantage of with the new CPUs launching soon is they're probably trying to clear out inventory of the 7950X3D by making it a great deal right now. So it's a great deal. I'm gonna go ahead and edit this list so I can make a few more comments about some of the other parts. This is a great choice for CPU cooler, the Peerless Assassin from Thermalright, but Thermalright actually made a better one, and it's actually a little bit cheaper, the Phantom Spirit 120 SE. There's also the Phantom Spirit Evo, which is even a little bit better than the Phantom Spirit SE, but this one's like a buck cheaper, so that seems like a no-brainer. I also applaud the choice of motherboard here, the B650 Gaming XAX. ATX motherboard from Gigabyte is a solid all-around motherboard as long as you can get past the sort of brown PCB. Great features and build quality, but I would still classify this as a more of a budget-end board. It's still gonna be totally fine for a 7950X3D. I had to hunt it down a little bit, but a very nice upgrade from that is gonna be the ASRock B650E Tai Chi Lite. ASRock has done a great job providing a lot of value for their motherboards with this generation, especially with a lot of motherboards suddenly costing $400, $500, $600 plus. Do note that this is an EATX motherboard, but it's gonna have a lot of added bells and whistles versus the Gigabyte Gaming XAX, like a surface-mounted debug LED, surface-mounted power and reset, and just overall, a better board for overclocking. Of course, PC Part Picker has immediately warned me that I chose a motherboard that is not compatible with the case, the NZXT H6 Flow. So if we switch to this motherboard, we also need to switch to a case that supports EATX motherboards, which basically means the H7. Very nice NZXT to make that sequential step up from the H6 to the H7. You can actually find the 2022 version of the H7 for about $75. But we'll stick with the current version, which is about 20 bucks more. And there you go, rounding everything else out, we have a Corsair Vengeance, very sensible DDR5 6000 kit. 32 gigs is the bare minimum, I think, for a new AM5 build. We got a nice Crucial P3 Plus 2TB NVMe SSD. Since we were also set on a 4080 Super, I'm glad to say that there are a handful of options there that are also less than $1,000. I went with the PNY Accelerate Gaming because it's 980. There's actually an even cheaper version for 965 right now, the Virto OC over on Amazon. So take your pick there. And we also have a nice power supply as well, 80 plus gold rated, fully modular, and it does have a dedicated 12VH power connector as well. I know it's not 12V 2x6, but it's an RTX 4080, not a 4090, so make sure those plugs are plugged in all the way and you should be just fine. So I like this as a really solid high-end build, high core count. It's gonna be great for gaming with the 3D V-Cache. It's got a sensible air cooler on there. And you know, I even upped the price of this by $100 or so by swapping out a couple parts and going with a slightly higher end motherboard. But either way you go here, this is just gonna be a beastly system all around. And really the only like drawback or caveat about this build is the 9000 series launching in about 2 weeks. So there's gonna be a question there as to how much faster 9000 series is. Is the deal on the 7950X3D going to be worth it? Also, when 9000 series launches in 2 weeks, we're not gonna get the X3D CPUs yet. It's probably gonna be 2-3 months after that that we see the X3D versions. So for a gaming specific slash multi-use build and someone who needs a new system right now, this is a totally solid choice for around $2,000 for the base system. But that is gonna wrap it up for this episode of Build Fix number 5. A huge thank you to PC Part Picker for sponsoring this series, and I'll post links to these build lists as well as other helpful links down in the description below, so check that out. Also down there you'll find a link to my store at paulshardware.net where you can help support my channel by getting yourself some awesome merch, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Thank you guys so much for watching this video, and we'll see you all in the next one.